Hello and welcome to this Global Spec Water Quality and Water Reclamation online event. Most green building programs identify sustainable building materials, energy efficient appliances, and water conservation fixtures. However, there is less guidance for water reuse systems. That's why the NSF International has developed a new standard for water reuse. Now, before introducing our speaker, we'd like to invite you to submit questions at any point during this presentation by using the Submit Question button at the base of this video console. Also, some of the presentations you will see today include detailed information, so we would encourage you to click the Download PPT button so that you can follow along with your own copy of the PowerPoint slides. James Bell is Executive Vice President of Bio-Microbics. Mr. Bell has 35 years of experience in the wastewater treatment industry. As Vice Chairman of the Joint Committee on Wastewater for the NSF and active member of the Small Community for the WEF, along with the National Onsite Wastewater Recycling Association, he continues to pioneer the future of onsite wastewater treatment. James, welcome to today's event.
Welcome. I am James Bell, and I'm the Executive Vice President of Bio-Microbics. Today, we're going to be talking about the NSF ANSI Standard 350 for decentralized systems for water reuse. Bio-Microbics is a manufacturer of decentralized wastewater treatment and stormwater systems for the residential, small community, and commercial applications. We are centrally located in Kansas, with our marine division centrally located in Missouri. I'd like to now give a general overview of Bio-Microbics products and systems. Bio-Microbics specialized in fixed integrated treatment technologies that are used in the decentralized infrastructure. Our products are installed in locally available tanks and cover a broad range from small communities such as this strip mall with a MIFAS system to treat the wastewater, down to a single home application using our NSF Standard 40 and 245 MicroFast technologies. The effluent from our treatment technologies is dispersed through a soil-based dispersal system. This method of effluent dispersal is beneficial as it recharges the groundwater. It can also be used for subsurface irrigation with drip irrigation technologies. Bio-Microbics also provides screen pumping systems that can be used to replace large diameter sewers with small diameter pressurized sewers. These sewers are then connected to Bio-Microbics treatment systems to provide high quality effluent for distribution to local green spaces as shown by this sports field. Our technologies also provide water solutions for nutrient reduction using our NitroFast technology as shown for this school. Bio-Microbics is a leader in single home treatment systems for water reuse using our NSF 350 biobarrier membrane technology. Bio-Microbics also has solutions for failed septic dispersal systems that are biologically failed. Our RetroFast technology has been verified under the EPA ETV verification program. Bio-Microbics provides solutions for high-strength commercial wastewater sources using our high-strength FAST technology for treatment. We also provide grease removal with our fog hog system and utilize our sanity screen to control the grease from interfering with the biological process. In addition to providing decentralized solutions, Bio-Microbics also addresses the environmental needs of the marine market through our Cyanco-FAST division. Cyanco-FAST utilizes the FAST technology for treatment on virtually every type of vessel and offshore platform. These systems are installed on what is considered the greenest boats in the world. Bio-Microbics also provides solutions for stormwater treatment for use in commercial applications where our biostorm treatment technology can be used. We also address the needs of additional aeration for treatment using our Lixer aeration technology. Bio-Microbics biobarrier membrane technology can also be used for large commercial applications as shown with this golf course clubhouse. The effluent reuse water can provide extra water for irrigation of the golf course as well as other ornamental uses. From this review, one can see that our fixed integrated treatment technologies are a solution to the decentralized infrastructure needs of any size community. We are now going to talk about the national standards for wastewater recycle and reuse treatment technologies for non-potable applications. NSF International is a certification body based out of Ann Arbor, Michigan, and is responsible for writing the standards for both residential water and drinking water. All of these standards groups are made up of three different components. One third of the group is made up of manufacturers who are familiar with the technologies used for water and wastewater treatment. In addition, the other third is made up of users who are both consumers of the products as well as engineers who use the products and utilities that are responsible for these products. The third group is made up of the federal, state, and local regulators, which regulate the products. By using these three different groups, we are assured of having standards which are applicable to and acceptable to all three segments of the market. NSF International is uniquely positioned to be developing water reuse standards because they also develop standards for on-site wastewater as well as on-site drinking water. If we look at the on-site wastewater applications, NSF has developed standard 40, which is for on-site residential wastewater, as well as NSF 245, which is used for residential nutrient reduction. NSF has also developed standards for drinking waters for point of use or point of entry. These include filtration systems as well as membrane systems and disinfection systems for drinking water needs. We're now going to talk about the NSF standard 350 for water reuse for residential and commercial applications. The NSF committee that was established in 2007 to write this standard was made up of drinking water and wastewater experts, as well as plumbing component manufacturers and other interested parties, including the National Resource Defense Council, as well as the regulatory community for both the EPA and other state and local organizations. Why is there a need for developing a water reuse standard? Our current centralized infrastructure is aging, undersized, expensive to repair and expand, and designed to develop one level, that being a high level of water treatment. We're also faced with dwindling water supplies and a dwindling water quality within those supplies. The opportunities exist to reuse wastewater on site. Why? The water's already available on site. There's no cost or energy needed to transport the water. Large percentage of this is basically of a low contamination, which can be treated on site for both non-potable uses, both indoor and outdoor. There's a broad scope of water sources available for reuse. There's the basic naturally generated sources of rainwater and stormwater, but those come on infrequent intervals. There's also the constant reoccurring source of water being from naturally generated gray water or residential wastewater. And if we look at this pie chart of our water uses, we find that over 25% of it is used for toilet flushing. So if there's an opportunity to use reuse water for this toilet flushing, it'll eliminate the need of 25% of the water demand. There's other broad scopes of reuse applications, including irrigation, as well as construction uses for fire protection and dust control. The scope of Standard 350 is such that it's for residential and commercial treatment systems. The sources can be gray water or combined wastewater, being the gray water and the black water. And the uses are for indoor toilet and urinal flushing, as well as outdoor surface and subsurface irrigation. The sizes that are utilized in this standard are for residential up to 1,500 gallons a day for residential wastewater, and for gray water, the same 1,500 gallons a day. The standard also addresses commercial applications exceeding 1,500 gallons a day. Commercial facilities are businesses that are defined here and are likely to handle high amounts of commercial concentrated wastewaters and commercial strength cleaners. The overall test requirement of 350 is not only just a performance-based criteria. We also evaluate the water tightness, the noise level, the accessibility, and making sure that there's failure sensors and a signaling for mechanical and electrical issues. There's also, we make sure there's bypass protection so there can be no malfunction or overflow. And the standard also makes sure that the product literature that's provided to the owner, the installer, and the service provider is adequate. This is all in addition to a performance-based standard. The performance evaluation for residential wastewater is actually carried out at wastewater treatment plants and where raw wastewater is fed to the treatment system to simulate that coming out of a residential application. The gray water, though, is a synthetic mixture. It's, first of all, a large percentage of it is secondary residential wastewater. In other words, it's wastewater from a secondary treatment plant in which components are added to establish a laundry wastewater gray water and a bathing gray water. But in both cases, in the development of these synthetically generated wastewaters, it's a requirement that the wastewater fall within the influent test water characteristics as defined within the standard. The product test conditions for Standard 350 are such that the manufacturer provides the installation instructions and it's installed per that manufacturer's instructions. There's no restrictions for seasons. It's operated in accordance to the manufacturer's instructions for a minimum of 6 months. During that time period, no service or maintenance is allowed for the entire test. All data is reported, and there's no allowance to discard any data. The gray water dosing is slightly different depending upon whether it's a bathing or laundry application. But in all of our testing, we subject the systems to stress test, representing what you would experience in a single home residence. For example, there's a wash day surge in which multiple loads of laundry are run in addition to the normal wastewater load. There's also a power and equipment failure. Realizing these are residential systems, there'll be times when there'll be power outages or equipment failures. So the system is operated for 48 hours without power, and as soon as it comes up, it's required to perform. There's also the issue with vacations. So the system is run for 2 weeks without any loading at all to assure that when the family returns from a no loading condition or a vacation period, the system performs adequately right away. The influent and effluent constituents are measured, and these measurements are based on 24-hour composites of the influent and the effluent. The acceptable pass-fail criteria is divided into two categories. There's the residential category and the commercial category. They are mainly distinguished between the two parameters being turbidity and E. coli. For the residential systems, we're looking for a turbidity of 5 NTUs and E. coli of 14 most probable number per 100 ml. For the commercial, we're looking for a higher quality water quality, In this case, we want the turbidity to be less than 2 and the E. coli to be non-detectable or less than 2.2. The standard also allows for the testing of one model size and then the approval of other model sizes based upon engineering evaluation and proper proportioning of the sizes to the various model flow criteria. So in summary, the new NSF standard provides the proper testing criteria to enable this reuse technologies to come into the market, and also is one piece in a series of steps in developing a criteria for water reuse. Bio-Microbics was the first manufacturer to be certified under NSF 350. We tested under residential wastewater criteria and for our models 500, 1,000, and 1,500 gallon a day. The treatment technology is a biological membrane reactor. By that, we use a membrane which is submerged in the wastewater. We add air to that wastewater to develop the bacterial population, and we use a small pump to draw a small vacuum pressure through the membrane to pull the water out of the wastewater in a high quality water for reuse. The biobarrier 0.5 for a single home sits in a two-compartment settling tank or septic tank. The first compartment is for settling and uses a Santee screen for fine screening of the wastewater. The second compartment includes the biobarrier membrane technology, which is used to aerate the wastewater and develop a high-quality effluent being pulled from the membrane unit for water reuse. This treatment technology was certified under NSF 350 as well as standards 40 and 245. This shows a single home treatment system showing the biobarrier technology, which is a membrane technology. This is an installation for a single home using the biobarrier technology. You will note that it's very landscape friendly with the openings being at grade, but you will also note that with a little proper landscaping, this can be very easily concealed as this homeowner located the system in the front of their yard. This is a commercial application of the biobarrier technology at 4,500 gallons a day. This shows the aeration intensity within the membrane system, which is used to not only keep the membrane clean, but at the same time provide the air for the biological reaction. Our test results under NSF 350 are divided into two categories. This first category is the testing we use for standard 40 and 245. You will see in these test results that we have BOD and TSSs that were non-detectable. You'll also see that we were able to reduce the total nitrogen in the effluent to less than 10 milligrams per liter. Our NSF 350 testing results show that, again, we had very low BOD and TSS, the non-detectable range. But you'll also note that the turbidity, the average turbidity over this test that lasted up to about 180 days or 6 months, was 0.25 NTU, with the E. coli running at 1.3 most probable number per 100 ml based upon a geometric mean. Now, if we compare that with the pass-fail criteria for NSF standard 350, you will note that although we tested under the residential criteria, there being the 5 NTU and 14 E. coli, we're actually able to obtain results which are very comparable to the commercial criteria of less than 2 and less than on the turbidity and less than 2.2 on the E. coli. So Bio-Microbics provides a solution for the water reuse under the new NSF Standard 350. And as we begin to look at needs for water reuse, this is something serious that needs to be evaluated and will probably be something that you hopefully will use in the future. And with that, I open it up for questions.
Thank you, James, for that great presentation. We do have some questions that came in, so let's get right to them, shall we? The NSF ANSI standard 350 for gray water treatment uses synthetic challenge water. Was this synthetic challenge water validated for its water characteristics?
Yes, the NSF 350 standard does use synthetic water for the gray water challenge. This was done basically after some research work that the committee did in regards to some work done in Australia for water reuse testing. In addition, NSF developed this challenge water and tested it extensively to make sure that it validated according to the influent criteria established for gray water influence sources.
Next question up, what is the purpose of a stress test?
NSF has over the years developed stress testing, especially for residential wastewater systems, which is included in the NSF 350 standard. These stress tests are used to simulate events that occur in a single-family home so that the system can be properly compared to those events, such as a wash day where multiple loads of laundry are dumped into the system in addition to the normal loading, as well as vacation periods and other type of stress tests which simulate what occurs in a residential environment.
Does the NSF ANSI Standard 350 address where the reclaimed water can be used?
Yes, the NSF 350 standard does address where the water can be reused. Primarily, it establishes if the water is being used indoors for toilet flushing, and it also establishes outdoor usages such as for irrigation, including even subsurface irrigation for edible crops.
Why is there a difference in reuse water quality between a residential system as compared to a commercial system?
When the NSF committee was looking at this, we did some research work which established these type of effluent qualities or water qualities that we were looking for. There was a distinction made between residential and commercial from the standpoint that if you think about it, in a residential environment, your family is subjected to the pathogens and viruses and have an immunity system build up for them. So therefore, reusing of that water within your own residence does not require such a high water quality. But if that same wastewater is being spread out and used in a commercial application for multiple families, then you want a higher quality of water to assure that the immunity system isn't challenged by the quality of the water.
Is the NSF ANSI Standard 350 only a testing standard?
The NSF Standard 350 is a testing standard, but it also, under the NSF criteria, it's a certification policy. NSF is a certifying body, and by a certifying body, that provides the review of systems. Being NSF certified means you're going to have a yearly audit in which NSF comes in and audits your equipment to make sure it's equivalent to the standards and it's the same system that was tested. In addition, these audits also cover actual installations to make sure that what is sold and is installed in the field actually meets the NSF criteria and is the same equipment as tested.
What is a membrane?
A membrane is a barrier, a very thin layer that is used to separate either ions or solids. Probably the most common membrane that people are familiar with is reverse osmosis, which is actually separating ions such as salt water. But the membrane technology we use is a little bit larger opening so as not to require as much of a driving force. And it's used to separate solids to keep the bacteria in the viruses and the pathogens inside the wastewater system and allow the clean water to be pulled out.
What is the difference between a membrane and an MBR?
A membrane is the actual material that's located on the surface in which the barrier to provide the separation of the solids and the liquid. An MBR system stands for Membrane Biological Reactor. The Membrane Biological Reactor is essentially the entire treatment zone, including the biological process, which is degrading the organics, and the membrane is used to separate the clean water from this biological reaction.
What are the required maintenance and the frequency of cleaning for a biobarrier MBR?
The NSF Standard 350 requires the system be operated for a minimum of 6 months without any service. So the service criteria for a typical membrane biological reactor certified under standard NSF Standard 350 is going to be from 6 months to a year. And that typical service criteria will require a chemical cleaning of the membrane in situ so that the membrane can be cleaned and brought back into service very quickly.
Next up, what is the power cost per month to operate a biobarrier MBR?
A biobarrier MBR can be operated for less than a dollar a day. At an electrical cost of 10 cents per kilowatt hour, that would come out to around 75 cents a day, much less than the cost of a soda at a gas station, for example.
All right, we've got time for one more. Would you use a separate piping in your house to reuse the water?
Yes, the current plumbing codes require that if water is brought back in the house, that the reclaimed water is carried in what's called purple pipe. In other words, the piping is dyed purple to designate that this is reclaimed water for water reuse. The NSF Standard 50 also requires that if water is brought back into the home for toilet flushing, that reclaimed water maintain a chlorine residual so that it is safe in the use for toilet flushing.
Okay, it looks like that's all the time we have for questions today. Thanks so much, James, for being here today and for answering all of our attendees' questions. Now, before moving on to explore the exhibit hall of this event, please take a moment to click the Take Survey button and let James know how he did today. Your feedback helps us improve the quality of our Global Spec events, making them an even better investment of your time. Now, in between sessions, head to the exhibit hall where you'll find manufacturer product reps, engineers, technical specialists, and other professionals waiting to answer your questions. Remember, you can see any of today's presentations during our on-demand period, but exhibitor representatives are only here on the day of the live event, so spend time with them while you can. And please experience our latest innovation, the Knowledge Exchange, offering product demonstrations and our hot topic audio briefs. The Knowledge Exchange is also home to our event price center, so make it a point to visit. Share your thought leadership point of view by speaking at one of our events. You can find the speaker submittal form at our event help desk in the exhibit hall. We'd certainly like to thank you for spending your day with us, and we'll see you back here in the conference center a little later on.